1848. Gold's found in California. The news transforms the newly named port of San Francisco, and by the end of 1849, it was a booming gold town of 25,000 people, mainly men. 6,000 of these men were from Britain's convict colonies in Australia. Tattooed, branded, and marked with the lash, San Franciscans feared and despised such brutish foreigners, calling them behind their backs the Sydney Ducks. The Sydney Ducks are cackling in the pond was a common phrase in Gold Rush San Francisco whenever a particularly atrocious crime was committed. When the first Sydney Ducks docked in San Francisco, they gravitated to the Latino district around Telegraph Hill. At the base of Telegraph Hill and up its ravines, they set up English-style taverns and boarded houses in an area that soon became notorious as Sydney Town. The Ducks also took over the low-end brothels there. This is how the gangland historian Herbert Asprey, back in 1933, described the Ducks' invasion. "Branded hoodlums, ticket of leave men, these warped criminals saw in San Francisco a new theatre of operation and easy living." So why were the Sydney Ducks so warped, as Herbert Asprey put it? Unable to transport their convicts to America, as they did before America's War of Independence, Britain established penal colonies in Australia at the other end of the earth. Convicts, it was considered, should be subject to strict discipline and severe punishment. Such savage treatment turned men into depraved and savage beasts. And look at how the women convicts reacted. And this is in church. Rather than break the convict spirit, it created a hatred, contempt, and resistance to authority, the like of which generally polite and civilized Americans had never seen before. And so the hordes from Australia invaded San Francisco. Just 3 years after the US Navy invaded the remote Mexican outpost that became San Francisco. San Francisco's evolution as an American city started in 1846 when the US Navy invaded Mexican California through the tiny fishing village of Yuba Buana, as San Francisco was then called. What America ignored when they captured Mexico's wild and isolated region of Alta California, Upper California, was that anyone from Australia was banned by the Mexican government. Such was Australia's mainly English convicts' terrible reputation for mayhem and violence. Noted this American academic in 1972. "Australians have had little impact on American history, but the Sydney Ducks made Sydney Town the most notorious criminal district in the history of the United States." On Christmas Eve 1849, the first of six great fires attributed to the Sydney Ducks started in San Francisco's upmarket Portsmouth Square, formerly the Plaza. Damage was $1 million. But Portsmouth Square was rebuilt in just 4 months, then burnt down again. This time the damage was $3 million. The Ducks are cackling in the pond, went the San Francisco saying. So how did the Sydney Ducks get their name, a name they hated, took as an insult, and were likely to kill anyone who called them a duck to their face? One possibility is their convict uniforms were made of duck canvas, a heavy cotton material. Another is that after years in leg irons, they shuffled like ducks. After the first great fire at the end of 1849, a census showed that off San Francisco's 25,000 population, only 300 were women, and 200 of those were prostitutes. Indeed, women were so scarce in Gold Rush San Francisco, in the crowded dance halls, you'd find men dancing with men. A sign of more liberal times ahead, perhaps. The situation improved in the spring of 1850 when 200 women arrived from Sydney, Australia. San Franciscans call them Cyprians, a term for lewd and licentious prostitutes. Sex-starved miners crowded into rowboats in their hundreds to get at the women, fighting amongst themselves as they clambered aboard the ships. During the rest of 1850, over 2,000 females arrived in San Francisco. All but 100 were ladies of the night. By now, San Francisco's brothels were getting more and more upmarket. High-class whores from London, New York, New Orleans, and Paris made fortunes behind the curtains of the sex booths of Portsmouth Square's top casinos. Many prostitutes married prominent citizens and became leading San Francisco socialites. One local wit noted that women known for their loose behaviour in Sydney married respectable men in San Francisco and presumably mothered the social leaders of the city's next generation. 100,000 people streamed into California in 1849 alone. They included 14,000 from Australia. Half were intent on honest gold seeking or business ventures. The other half were robbing people on the gold fields or separating people from their money in Sydney Town. Sydney Town, San Francisco, of course. Where, said a contemporary journalist, the rich miners and well-off merchants and enterprisers would go slumming in Sydney Town, to visit the harbour tarts working for the Sydney Ducks, to watch strange games in obscene shows in which the Australians specialise. Visitors, unless well protected by bodyguards or the bribe law, found it easy to get their heads bashed in and their pockets emptied. For entertainment in Gold Rush San Francisco, anything, just about anything went. Bare-knuckle fighting was daily. So were animal fights, dogs versus bears, dogs against bulls, dogs versus men, bulls against bears, which is of course the origin of the stock market term, bulls and bears. But nothing was lower than what went on in Sydney Town. On top of barbaric fighting of every kind, the entrepreneurs of Sydney Town put on horrific live sex shows. Men and women with animals being a Sydney Town speciality. When the Ducks first arrived from Sydney in April 1849, a combination of New York street gangs, the very gangs featured in the film Gangs of New York, was already terrorizing San Francisco. Called the Hounds, the gang included members of New York gangs such as the Plug Uglies, the Dead Rabbits, and the Bowery Boys. The Hounds were a one-time US Army unit disbanded in California after America's victory in the Mexican-American War in 1848. They strutted around in military uniforms, demanding protection money from white businesses, beating Latinos and blacks senseless, purely for fun. They once sheared the ears off an African American and tore out a Mexican's tongue, simply because they answered back. Even so, the ducks were much worse than the hounds, say San Francisco City Records many times. The ducks were even more depraved than the hounds, and more adept at rabble-rousing. One particularly odious Sydney duck reportedly hung six Chinese gold miners up by their queues, or pigtails, and slit their throats. But the murder of people who weren't white didn't count towards San Francisco's early crime statistics, only the murder of whites. This map of early San Francisco shows Sydney Town next to the shaded area, which was then the waterfront and is now reclaimed land. To the right of Sydney Town is Telegraph Hill, where the ducks also lived. And Portsmouth Square, San Francisco's main square, is left of Sydney Town and marked in blue. But let's get back to San Francisco's annals and their account of the men from Australia. Dozens of murders had gone unsolved that spring of 1849, and none brought to justice. In San Francisco Harbor in 1849, 500 abandoned ships went to waste, deserted by crews and even their captains. Gold fever enticed 3,000 sailors to jump ship, including men from the US Navy. 42,000 gold seekers came overland. Up to 100,000 people arrived in California by land and sea in 1849 alone. They're now known, of course, as the 49ers. By late 1849, one in every five men in San Francisco was from Australia. They made the Australian Quarter, Sydney Town, the most dangerous district in the most violent city in the world. It was, wrote Herbert Asprey in 1933, the nearest approach to criminal anarchy that an American city has yet experienced. Of the first 16 white men arrested in San Francisco in 1849, 12 were ex-convicts from Sydney, but the crooked judiciary, taking kickbacks from the ducks, let them off. At least 100 murders were committed in a few months, said San Francisco's annals, without one execution. 1849 rolled into 1850, and in the new year, the most notorious of all Sydney ducks, James Stewart, began terrorizing San Francisco. Feared throughout California as English Jim, Stewart was said to have committed or assisted in more murders and burglaries during his time in California than any other man. Originally from Brighton, England, Stewart was just 16 when he was transported to Australia for 12 years for passing forged notes. Born in 1819, Stewart arrived in New South Wales in 1835. Ticket of leave 12 years later, in 1847, required him to stay down under, but Jim promptly absconded to New York. New York was the destination for felons on the run from Australia. There was one main reason. Relations between Britain and the United States were decidedly frosty in the 1840s, so there was no extradition treaty between the two countries. Partially because of London's opposition to American slavery. America, therefore, was a favourite haunt for escaped British convicts. But by 1850, San Francisco had far eclipsed New York as a place safe from the clutches of British law. 6 months earlier in 1849, according to Herbert Asprey, English Jim Stewart, together with a fellow escaped convict from Australia, known only as Bristol Bill, was causing havoc on America's East Coast. Jim Stewart and Bristol Bill worked their way through New York City and Boston up to Vermont, robbing at least 6 banks on the way, passing fake counterfeit notes and swindling whoever they could. In Vermont, Bristol Bill, said to be the son of an English MP, was captured and jailed for 14 years there. But Jim Stewart escaped, turning up in San Francisco in January 1850, at a time when months of torrential rains had turned the city's streets into mud so deep horses and mules sank and drowned. In a few months, recorded San Francisco's annals, English Jim Stewart became involved in more murders and burglaries than any other man in California. Jim Stewart arrived in San Francisco after the New York Hounds gang was run out of town for going one murder too far in their attacks on Latinos. The Hounds were bad for business, and prominent businessmen like Sam Brannan wanted them muzzled. And muzzled they were, hounded out of San Francisco by self-appointed law enforcers and a self-appointed court. The Latinos had a word for them: vigilantes. 230 angry citizens armed with muskets and pistols chased the Hounds out of San Francisco. 20 Hounds were caught by the militia and the gang's leaders given 10 years hard labour. But within days, all were released and most left San Francisco to return to New York.
And I bring you fire!
As we've heard, the first of 6 great fires blamed on the Sydney Ducks broke out on Christmas Eve, 1849. The Ducks, it was alleged, torched Denison's Exchange, an upmarket gaming hall on Portsmouth Square, because its management refused to pay for protection. 48 men from Sydney were arrested, not one was charged. Just 4 months later, in May 1850, San Francisco's second great fire broke out. Then a third great fire of San Francisco destroyed 400 buildings in June 1850, just a month later. All 3 fires started in the gambling district around Portsmouth Square as the wind blew away from Sydney town. The Sydney Ducks had borrowed the idea of using fire from the Australian Aborigines method of setting alight the bush to flush out game. From their time in Australia, the Ducks knew exactly how to avoid putting their own district in danger. 3 huge city infernos in just 6 months sent San Francisco's newspapers into a fury. Urgent government action was needed against the hoodlums from Australia, the papers demanded. A law was passed immediately ordering every business in Sydney town to shut its doors by midnight. The Ducks, of course, ignored this. Then they started a 4th great fire on December the 14th, 1850, in retaliation to what they perceived as government overreaction. Again, as usual, no one was arrested. English Jim Stewart had been in California for almost a year, and on a road near Marysville, some 125 miles northeast of San Francisco, English Jim Stewart shot a traveler dead and robbed him of $2,300. from Marysville, English Jim Stewart was tracked south to the city of Sacramento, where he had wasted no time partaking in a string of robberies. Caught red-handed housebreaking, English Jim was aboard Sacramento's prison brig, awaiting trial, when news came in about the Marysville murder. But before he could be taken back to Marysville to stand trial, he escaped by cutting through the ship's side and, heavily disguised, walking to Stockton, where he caught a steamboat back to San Francisco. It was here English Jim Stewart's gang of Sydney Ducks finally came unstuck. English Jim's second in command was an escaped convict originally from Manchester, England, Samuel Whittaker. Stewart and Whittaker led a gang of men from Australia on a violent crime spree. Then, on February the 19th, 1851, while still daylight, they robbed a store on one of San Francisco's main streets, Montgomery Street. Sam Whittaker believed the owner, Charles Jansen, had $17,000 worth of British gold sovereigns secreted away. Sovereigns he sold to Australian miners returning home. Stewart and Mackenzie broke into Charles Jansen's store, where English Jim beat Jansen senseless with a weighted lead cosh. And as the group of Sydney Ducks escaped with just $1,700, Stewart and Mackenzie were recognised in the daylight by a host of witnesses. The newspapers screamed for arrests, some even suggesting lynching, as did the business community, led by Sam Brannan. The people were angry too, forcing heavily armed police to enter Sydney town and arrest Stewart and Mackenzie. The trouble was, they arrested two Sydney Ducks who looked like Stewart and Mackenzie. The two innocent Ducks were locked up in San Francisco's City Hall. Before long, a huge crowd was outside the hall, baying for Australian blood. Next, 300 of these men attacked the City Hall courtroom to get at the two prisoners, but they were beaten back by the Washington Guard. Entrepreneur Sam Brannan wanted a public lynching. A trial was held immediately, the huge crowd chanting outside for the Australians to be hung. Lynch 'em, went the crowd. Instead, the two men were acquitted, then rearrested and put on trial again due to public pressure. This time they were found guilty, but instead of hanging, the two innocent Sydney Ducks were given 14 years hard labour. The duck they thought was English Jim Stewart was transported back to Marysville to stand trial for murder. Outraged at the sentences, the Sydney Ducks then torched San Francisco for a fifth time. 20 city blocks burned down over an area a mile long, nearly half a mile wide. Damage was $20 million, over $2 billion in today's money. The blaze, it was said, could be seen from 100 miles out at sea and from as far down the Californian coast as Monterey. As four times before, in the mad confusion of the fire, the Sydney Ducks roamed the burning streets in packs, looting the stores and warehouses, taking everything they could. But this time, there was resistance. Property owners, emboldened by the recent groundswell of resentment against the Sydney Ducks, shot at the looting Australians. A number of Sydney Ducks were shot and killed. Others were cornered by enraged citizens and beaten to death. This is a scene of the devastation after that fifth great fire. two Sydney thugs, Jack Edwards and Ben Lewis, were arrested for arson. But the corrupt courts on the east side of the plaza, or Portsmouth Square, let them go. This last fire was the last straw as far as Sam Brannan and San Francisco was concerned. 1 month later, in defiance of the law, a People's Vigilante Committee was formed. From now on, for the Sydney Ducks, their goose was cooked. First, an open letter appeared in San Francisco's newspapers promising a war of extermination against the men from Sydney, and gave them 5 days to leave town. The Sydney Ducks was a generic name given to all convicts from Australia, even if they didn't come from Sydney. Many of the worst behaved convicts of all were sent to Van Diemen's Land, today's island of Tasmania. One Sydney Duck from Van Diemen's Land was so bad he was known throughout San Francisco as the Miscreant. Described in San Francisco's annals as a large and nasty man, his name was John Jenkins, an escapee transported from Britain to Australia for life. This is San Francisco's Long Wharf, where John Jenkins stole a safe full of cash and, in full view of passers-by, put it in a rowing boat and set off across the harbour. And this is the fire bell, introduced to alert committee members whenever a Sydney Duck was spotted committing a crime. John Jenkins christened a monumental fire bell just 2 days after the vigilantes' declaration of war. Already the papers reported Australians fleeing San Francisco, but these were just the petty criminals. The hardcore Sydney Ducks like Jenkins just laughed at such threats. He certainly didn't expect to be chased and caught by three watermen who, after a fierce struggle, managed to overpower him and drag Jenkins before the Committee of Vigilance.
What Mora needs is hanging!
It was one of the first examples of an illegal kangaroo court on record. At midnight, they announced to the gathering crowd outside that Jenkins would hang. And around 2 that morning, the committee marched Jenkins, noose around his neck, to Portsmouth Square. A group of Sydney Ducks tried to rescue the prisoner, but were beaten off by almost 200 vigilantes. The police too tried to intervene, but were threatened with weapons. Even now, John Jenkins remained relaxed, chewing his mouthful of tobacco, still confident his Sydney mates would rush to his rescue. But the moment the police departed, about 2:10 a.m, the Miscreant was hung high in the air.
Well, death don't have no mercy in this land.
As John Jenkins painfully suffocated, some 20 members of the Committee of Vigilance took it in turns to individually hold the rope taut. They are all in this together. They would all be implicated in Jenkins' execution. At John Jenkins' inquest, Sam Brannan and 8 of the vigilantes were charged with his murder. The committee published a response in the newspapers. "Blame us all," it said. Furthermore, they ordered San Francisco's entire criminal population to leave the city immediately. Warnings were sent to prominent Sydney Ducks threatening their lives, and all incoming ships were boarded at the entrance to San Francisco Bay by the committee's vigilantes and checked for Australians and other criminals. Now take a look at this rare satirical cartoon, published in San Francisco in 1851. That's a Sydney Duck in the middle holding a burning branch, wood shavings and matches on the ground in front of him. They represent, of course, all the fires the Sydney Ducks have started in San Francisco so far. On the left are two crooked San Francisco City officials in top hats. On the Sydney Ducks' right, two Committee of Vigilance men arrest the Australian. Here, take the blunt, 19th century slang for money, the Duck says to the bent policeman to his left. On the right of the vigilantes is the Committee of Vigilance gallows, ready and waiting for a customer. Above that, vigilantes meet an incoming ship saying, "Oh, you're from Sydney, are you? Well, I conclude you'd best make tracks back again." It was bound to happen, wasn't it? In retaliation for the hanging of the miscreant John Jenkins on June the 22nd, 1851, the Sydney Ducks torched San Francisco for a sixth time. More than 18 city blocks were burned down. As usual, the wind blew from the north and east, and Sydney town was untouched. About a week after San Francisco's sixth great fire, English Jim Stewart was back in San Francisco from Monterey, where he had broken at least four Sydney Ducks out of prison there. By July the 1st, Stewart was here at the old Spanish settlement of Mission Dolores, casing the house of a rich Spaniard who Jim planned to burgle there. Stewart took this road, where he later said, "I took to the hills on the way back from the mission to avoid being seen, and was arrested on the sandhills, doing nothing." Stewart was caught by vigilantes hunting another thief. They were alerted by his knife and pistols, and by his English-Australian accent. This is the prison brig Euphemia, San Francisco's main prison in 1851. Stewart was put in a cell overnight, and it was probably here. Like many psychopaths, English Jim could be very charming, and by morning had convinced most vigilantes he was not English Jim, but an upstanding visitor from Canada. The Vigilance Committee was about to let Jim go when a change of guard brought a new sentry, who poked his head in the cell and immediately recognised the prisoner. Jim Stewart, it turned out, invested some of his ill-gotten gains in mining claims and once employed the guard, an American with Sydney Duck connections, to work a claim on the Yuba River near Marysville for 6 months. "Do you know who you've got here?" the guard told the vigilantes. "Why, you have got English Jim, or Jim Stewart, the man who murdered the Sheriff of Auburn." But wasn't English Jim Stewart up in Marysville on trial for a murder he was accused of committing there 7 months earlier? An urgent rethink was needed. The British consul was brought in, and Stewart interrogated throughout the night by the vigilantes. Only after he had been identified by about half a dozen people did Jim Stewart finally agree to confess all. His only condition was that he'd be handed over to the Californian justice system rather than be punished by the Committee of Vigilance. A dispatch rider was summoned to take a letter urgently to Marysville, some 125 miles northeast of San Francisco. The Sydney Duck they were about to hang may have been a rascal, but he was an English Jim, and he was innocent of murder. So who was this man about to hang for English Jim's crime? He was an escaped Sydney convict living in San Francisco under the alias Thomas Burdew. Burdew's real name was Arthur Acterson, from London's East End. Like English Jim, he had been transported to Australia, aged 16. Like English Jim, he absconded while on a ticket of leave, which meant you were free, but had to remain in Australia to serve out your sentence. Mercifully, the letter was delivered in Marysville just in time to stop Acterson's execution. It was the first case of mistaken identity in California's legal history. But the mistake was understandable. Both men were the spitting image, say reports of the day, of traditional 19th century depictions of Jesus Christ. All contemporary reports say Stewart and Atkinson, aka Burdue, looked identical. The same height, about 5'9", it's the same weight, the same scars, the same missing fingers. The Vigilance Committee minutes too emphasize English Jim's resemblance to Jesus Christ. They talk about Jim's charm, even saying English Jim Stewart was exceedingly handsome. So English Jim started his confession. He was born in Brighton, Sussex, he said, and transported to Australia for life for forgery. This was in 1835, the same year as Jim's Jesus Christ lookalike was transported. Both Acterson and Stewart were aged about 31 or 32 when arrested in San Francisco. During his confession, Jim Stewart let slip a clue to the enormity of the Sydney Ducks threat to California. It was this ominous possibility which in my view justifies totally the formation of the 1851 San Francisco Committee of Vigilance. I have heard hundreds remark, said English Jim, that the day would soon come when this country would be taken by the Sydney people. California surely has the Committee of Vigilance to thank that it wasn't. Now, being the rogue that he was, we can't believe everything Jim said in his confession. Most accounts say English Jim arrived in San Francisco from Central America. That's what he told the Vigilance Committee. But as we've already heard, Herbert Asprey told us in his 1933 history, The Barbary Coast, that Jim Stewart was involved in a string of crimes on America's eastern seaboard before fleeing to San Francisco. But rather than admit he sailed from New York or Boston, it stands to reason Jim would have lied about coming from Panama simply to put the authorities off the scent of any previous criminal history. Like most Sydney Ducks, Jim Stewart had a string of aliases. He also gave the vigilantes a string of convict accomplices, including his right-hand man, Samuel Whittaker, his enforcer, Bob McKenzie, and assorted law officials and jury members. It's surprising how many escaped convicts from Australia opened boarding or lodging houses when they arrived in San Francisco. Sam Whittaker and Ted McCormick, for example, opened the Port Phillip boarding house after escaping in 1849 from Australia. Naturally, gambling was essential in such Sydney town lodging houses, as were loose women and alcohol-fueled parties. They had innocent-sounding names like the Live and Let Live, Bird in Hand, or the Cottage of Content. Australian madams kept brothels called Rose Cottage or Heart in Hand. One such boarding housekeeper was an ex-convict called Tom Gibson, also known as Tom Belcher Kay, and English Jim confessed how Kay provided the Ducks with inside information. For reasons we can't fathom, this escaped and illiterate convict managed to secure for himself the important position of Port Warden of San Francisco. This enabled him to pinpoint for the Sydney Ducks ships ripe for robbing. Tom Belcher Kay was also a pimp with a string of brothels. His girls spiked their clients' drinks, stealing their gold, money and valuables, splitting the booty with Belcher Kay. Stewart even boasted of plans to burn San Francisco down for a seventh time. But if Jim thought the vigilantes would show mercy, he was in for a disappointment. Because at 2 that afternoon, the Kangaroo Court announced to the crowds outside that English Jim would hang. He reportedly said, "This is a goddamn tiresome business. Let's get it the hell over with." Cheered on by huge crowds, 400 vigilantes then marched English Jim, heavily manacled, through the streets of San Francisco. This would be the most important public hanging yet seen in the young city's history. The crowds were so enormous, spectators took to the harbour in their rowing boats and climbed up the rigging of ships to get a better view. Reported the Alta California newspaper on Stewart's execution. The immense crowd remained breathless, and Stewart, when under the gallows, said, "I die reconciled. My sentence is just." The rope was pulled, and in a moment, he was dangling in the air. As following John Jenkins' execution 3.5 weeks earlier, some 20-odd members of the Committee of Vigilance took it in turns to individually pull tight the rope hanging Jim Stewart. As with Jenkins, they would all share the blame. As this contemporary print's caption states, 500 of the Vigilance Committee were on duty at the execution. The caption concludes, "James Stewart was a Sydney convict. No criminal was ever more daring or successful, more reckless or cold-blooded." The unlawful hanging of English Jim Stewart split the community of San Francisco in two. Most people applauded it, but San Francisco's government, justice system, and the police condemned it. The city coroner found, like the earlier Jenkins hanging, that the execution was murder. California's governor, John McDougal, condemned the Committee of Vigilance for acting in defiance of the law. Sydney newspapers back in Australia accused the Vigilance Committee of race hatred and jealousy against foreigners. In San Francisco, a special jury, while regretfully acknowledging the execution was unlawful, categorically refused to charge the 500 or 600 members of the Committee of Vigilance. The jury also deplored the lack of action against the Sydney Ducks by the district court that had moved the vigilantes to take such drastic action. Emboldened, the committee immediately started arresting Sydney Ducks. The first of Stewart's gang arrested was tracked to here, Marysville, on July the 16th, 1851. He was a small, clean-shaven, vicious Irish sailor with a hot temper. James Burns, known as Jimmy from Town. Described as a burglar of celebrity, Jimmy Burns was spared the death penalty, given 10 years hard labour instead. 2 days later, on the American River, where gold was first found in 1848, the vigilantes caught up with the Sydney Duck George Adams, also known as Jack the Dandy. Described as of English birth and recently from Sydney, George Adams was Stewart's toolmaker. Jack got 20 years. For the next 11 days after arresting Adams, vigilante posses combed the gold mining districts looking for Stewart's second in command, Sam Whittaker. Then in Sacramento on July the 26, 1851, they arrested Robert McKinney, alias Bob McKenzie. McKenzie was with Stewart and Whittaker when they robbed and bashed Charles Jansen in Montgomery Street 5 months earlier in February. Originally from Cumberland in the very northwest of England, McKenzie was described in the Committee of Vigilance papers as a brutal, coarse-fibred man. But Samuel Whittaker was harder to track down, so the vigilantes arrested the next best thing. Whittaker's mistress, Mary Ann Hogan, as she was trying to escape on a Sydney-bound ship. Mary Ann Hogan, also a well-known fence, had been tipped off she was named in English Jim's confession. She also happened to be English Jim's mistress, as well as Sam Whittaker's. Said by Whittaker to have been a one-time Sydney convict, Mary Ann Hogan was a stylish woman who kept a lodging house in Sydney town. Reported to San Francisco Daily Herald. The famous Mrs. Hogan was seized on board a ship in the harbour and removed to the committee rooms. She is about 35 years of age, quite genteel in appearance, and one who might safely keep a crib without ever being suspected. Mary Ann Hogan admits nothing. She is released, then starts a 500-mile journey south to San Diego, where she has arranged a rendezvous with her lover, Samuel Whittaker. The wanted Sydney duck, Samuel Whittaker, makes it almost halfway as far as Santa Barbara, where he's recognised by the county sheriff, Valentine Hearn. Under guard, Whittaker is taken back to San Francisco by ocean steamer. The ship is met by the Vigilance Committee, an illegal body, of course. The vigilantes ask Sheriff Hearn to turn Samuel Whittaker over to them, rather than the San Francisco police. Sheriff Hearn has no problem obliging. Sam Whittaker, 29, only admits to attempted murder after the vigilantes bring in a prostitute who tells how Whittaker tried to shoot her. The Sydney duck transported from Manchester, England, also cut up her pimp with a knife. Whittaker then tells the vigilantes how many Sydney ducks in San Francisco are escaped convicts from Van Diemen's Land. These men are so bad, he says, they won't allow them in Sydney. Whittaker tells the vigilantes about the three Edwards brothers from Van Diemen's Land, escaped English convicts all, who terrorised the Sacramento River. Samuel Whittaker tells how he helped Robert Windred escape, the Sydney duck arrested by mistake for Whittaker's part in the Montgomery Street robbery. Whittaker got Windred onto a ship to Australia on the morning of the Great Fire of May 1851. Windred made it back to New South Wales, where he lived a respectable life, dying in 1901, aged 79. This is a photograph of Joe Windred, the only photograph we have of one of the infamous Sydney ducks of Gold Rush San Francisco. On August 20th, 1851, after a third illegal trial, the committee sentenced Sydney duck Sam Whittaker and Bob McKenzie to death. The Californian governor was furious, and the following day, with San Francisco's first elected sheriff, Mexican-American war hero Colonel Jack Hayes, they rescued the two Sydney ducks from the vigilantes' headquarters. They had also tried to rescue English Jim, of course, but had been denied. But the Committee of Vigilance were in no mood to be denied either, and the next day, with a lookout on Telegraph Hill to watch the exercise yard, the committee raided the county jail. And to avoid a confrontation with the sheriff, the Vigilance Committee members had taken him to a bullfight. At gunpoint, the two Sydney Ducks were taken back to Vigilante headquarters, where a baying crowd saw them lynched within 20 minutes.
Well, death don't have no mercy in this land.
Governor McDougall and the city authorities did nothing. The Committee of Vigilance had won an emphatic victory against crime for the people of San Francisco, but in doing so, with no effective opposition from the authorities, had planted the seeds of a vigilante culture that would predominate in the American West for years to come. Every Sydney Duck in San Francisco was then given a stark choice. Get out of San Francisco, get out of California, or get executed. This threat, together with massive gold discoveries in the Australian state of Victoria, saw the men from Australia leave California in their thousands. Amongst those who escaped were the infamous Belcher Kay and half a dozen other members of the Stewart and Mackenzie gang. They escaped by steamer from San Diego to Panama and were never seen again. Vigilantes from San Francisco tried to intercept them when the ship docked in Mexico, but missed them by a whisker. Some Sydney Ducks looked for other parts of America to prey on and were still being lynched illegally in California as late as 1855. But it wasn't just those from Australia who flocked down under in 1851. In September, one of the biggest ever gold finds was made in the new Australian colony of Victoria. One year younger than California, Victoria was the new California, and 10,000 Americans joined returning Australians and British amongst the hundreds of thousands flocking to the gold fields down under. Back in San Francisco, with the menace of the Sydney Ducks gone, the Committee of Vigilance had no dangerous criminals to pursue, so lapsed into inactivity. Australian standover men did resurface in San Francisco in 1854, but before they could get established, the vigilantes reformed. Lawbreakers were run out of town and four men lynched. By August 1856, San Francisco's vigilantes felt their job was done, and the Committee of Vigilance disbanded for good. After a final street parade in full dress uniform, through cheering crowds, they made a public display of handing in their weapons, garlanded with flowers. Predating San Francisco's famous flower power by 110 years. In the 1860s, San Francisco's old Sydney town began to acquire a new name. It became known as the Barbary Coast and remained a place notorious for wild living until the 1930s. Today, the story of the English convicts from Australia who thought they one day might take California has virtually been erased from history. Most people wouldn't know they ever existed. Perhaps the reason is this. For half a century, some 50 years, well into the 19th century, the reputation of everyone from Australia was contaminated in the United States by the memory of these mainly English convicts from down under. No wonder the Sydney Ducks have been whitewashed from history.